The mules are in the corral. Welcome to Mule Talk, and I'm Cindy K. Roberts, your host.
And my sidekick,
our author, TV personality, and world-renowned mule trainer, Meredith Hodges of the Lucky Three Ranch.
We're back in the studio. Of course, Meredith has a really awesome topic to talk about today, the suitability of mules and donkeys for children. Meredith, what have you learned?
What haven't I learned?
Oh, that's good.
Yeah, like we were talking about, we both grew up in rural America, and we both grew up with ponies. And they have got to be God's worst gift to children. But on the other hand, God's best gift to children. Because growing up with a nasty pony will teach you a lot about being around equines. And this is how we learn. And I think kids these days are kind of short-changed because they don't get the opportunity to grow up with these animals. And a lot of the urban thinking and even some of the rural thinking these days, that these animals, and especially donkeys, are really cute. And if they're small, oh, they're even cuter. And they have false expectations about these animals behaving like dogs. And in fact, I've heard a lot about mules and donkeys are a lot like dogs and you can train them like dogs. Well, that's not necessarily true because they are bigger than dogs for the most part. And they're a lot smarter than dogs. And so even the animals themselves, they need a certain amount of training to be safe around children. And donkeys, not so much as mules. Mules are half horse, so they've got that mean little pony streak in them. And even big horses do that. And as we were discussing, if a mule or a donkey spooks and you're standing in front of them, a mule or donkey, if they have room to, if they're spooked, they'll just go around you. But a horse will go right over the top of you. Ooh. A pony will go right over the top of you. Mm. And they don't really care. They don't think about that. They stop and think about it later if they think at all. Mules and donkeys, I've found, too, that even if you get rolled underneath their body and into their legs, they will try really hard not to step on you. A horse doesn't even think about it. They just, if they step on you, they step on you. You know, when you grow up with these animals, there's a lot to be learned. Like you, I was 2 years old when I was introduced to my pony, but I was also introduced to a 16-hand saddlebred / quarter horse that my mother bought for me. And she just told me, she says, well, you can ride that horse when you can saddle it yourself. Well, I was very creative, and so I would get the horse up next to the fence and drag my little saddle up the fence and put it on the horse.
Oh,
went
boy.
Ahead and got the cinched up and everything. I had to crawl down to the bottom to get the cinch and then loop it there and then climb back up the fence to get it tight and all of that kind of stuff. I had to climb up the fence to put the bridle on. And that's how I got on, too. You know, I couldn't get my foot up to the stirrup. No way. It was only halfway down her body. That's not even talking about down by her legs, you know, so... So I figured out a way to get on and off my horse and ride her around the pen, and that was fun. That was fun for a while. And as I got bigger, then I was able to do more. And I learned a lot about being around the animals, too. I had the horse and the pony to ride, but I was also held responsible for cleaning the pens, not only for my horse and my pony, but for my sister's ponies, too. So I got the privilege of cleaning up manure every morning and every afternoon. And there's a lot to be learned with that, too, because it gave me time to hang around the animals and just be with them.
Right.
And they kind of like that, and they helped in their own way. They tipped the wheelbarrow over and made me do it twice. Yeah. and things like that that you learn. You get really mad about it when you're little like that and you yell at them, but then they just stand there and look at you sideways like, what's your problem? So you do learn a little bit of patience with that too. And you learn how to get these things cleaned up and look after them. You learn how important it is for them to have their feeding times on a regular schedule, because if the hay's not there and you're running overtime, they'll come over and knock you down. They'll go, hey, get out of here. Go get the hay, you know, and all of that.
Oh, yeah.
Got to know these animals pretty well just by exposure when I was really young. And there's a lot of lessons to learn just by being around the animals. Well, one lesson I learned, too, is when I got older, I was about 11, 12 years old. I was in 4-H, and I bought four Herefords. My mother bought four Herefords for me, I should say. And they were my cattle project. And I thought, oh, this is going to be a cinch, because I've been around the horses and the ponies and everything. And so these cows are going to be, you know, really easy to halter break and lead and groom and all this stuff. Well, cows are a little different than horses and mules and donkeys are. And I had one in there that was just, her name was Sandy. And Sandy, I'd go in the pen, and the other three cows were really nice, and they'd stand still while I was grooming them, and they'd lead really well. But Sandy would chase me. And when she caught me, she put her head right under my butt and just lifted up and launched me over the fence, man. I learned from those things how to roll when I hit the ground and not get hurt. I mean, a lot of people, your first instinct is to stick your arms out to block the fall. But I learned that if I tucked myself up into a little ball and just rolled, then I didn't get hurt as bad. So that was pretty good. And I never did break any bones around these equines. Later on, when I got with the mules, I was kind of naive and ignorant about driving, and I didn't wear a helmet, and I hitched up a very green mule in the indoor arena without groundwork, and she ran off, knocked me out of the cart. I hit my head on a post. The mule kept running around the arena. My husband said, I got up, chased down the mule, stopped the mule, unharnessed her, and then took her back to her stall and passed out again for the rest of the day. I ended up in the hospital all day, but I didn't want to spend the night there, so I insisted they let me go home, which they did, and that was fine.
Sure.
But, you know, when you grow up around these animals, a lot of people grow up thinking, oh, they're big, they're dangerous, and then you tack on all those old rumors about mules being stubborn and ornery, and you can't train them, you got to hit them with a 2x4, they'll attack you, and all this kind of stuff. It makes you think mules are even more dangerous than horses. And so I can see where a lot of these attitudes are coming from. And people in general, there's a lot of people that are just staying away from them. They don't want to be around any big animals like that. But there is so much to be learned by being around them. And then you get the physical exercise of riding them, which is really good for your body posture, your strength, your overall health, because it aligns your spine and makes you kind of go in good posture when you're on the ground. If you ride, learn to ride correctly, it enhances everything about you, physically and mentally. So they really are a good thing to be around. But you really got to learn how to be around them. And there are very few people these days that really know that. And then when they see these tiny donkeys, these mini donkeys and mini mules and miniature horses and everything, they look at them like they're supposed to be pets. And then there's rumors going around that, oh yeah, but long ears is just like training a dog. Well, not exactly. They're really not. They're bigger. They're stronger. They don't want to do something. They can be much more resistant than a dog can. A dog is just looking at you with his tongue hanging out going, what do you want me to do? I don't care. Beat me to death. I don't care.
Right.
Well, that's not a mule or a donkey.
There you
not go. By any stretch.
Yeah.
You know? If they don't like what you're doing, they're going to fight with you. So it's really important that you get the education to know what mules and donkeys are all about. And that's the purpose of our podcast and all the articles and books and videos that we do, is to give people all the information they need to be around these animals and do the right things. Now, as I mentioned, you know, when these kids are very, very small, they can approach any equine as long as there's no adult around. If there's no adult around, you know, we come on the scene and we go, oh my God, my kid is underneath that animal between its legs. And it's that very, oh my God, and that fear that we feel that causes the equine to react and not think about what he's doing all of a sudden. Initially, the kid has no vibes of fear. They have no vibes of doing anything to the animal. They're very naive. They're very innocent. The animal knows it. And that's why kids can get near animals that come from kill pens and everything, and the animals act 180 degrees from what they are, how, you know, the reasons for being in the kill pen. Because they know that these kids are innocent and mean them no harm. It's us adults with all of these preconceived expectations that we have that get these animals all wound up and actually make them dangerous. And so it's important that we realize that, we keep a calm head ourselves when we're around our animals, and we go ahead and teach the kids how to be around the animals. And part of our obligation is to know the differences in the different animals, the mules, the donkeys, the horses, the ponies. And a lot of people ask me questions about, well, are long ears appropriate for children? And I tell them, as with any equine, choosing the right individual for your child is of primary importance. As a general rule, we find donkeys to be excellent for beginning riders because of their patient, quiet nature, and good common sense. And they can be the best possible babysitter. There's a lot of things to consider when choosing a donkey for your child, though. The first rule to observe is to never get a donkey jack for your child. Although they may be sweet and docile by nature, donkey jacks are governed by a strong natural instincts, so his character tends to be inconsistent. You have to realize he's a breeding animal, and he needs to be treated as such, and most jacks need to be housed by themselves and not put out with herds. Even trying to pasture breed a jack is really risky with your females because they can get pretty rough, and they can hurt them. And it's the same thing if they're around people and children. Even a donkey genet can be dangerous if they're pregnant or nursing offspring or when they're in heat. A donkey gelding is probably the best choice from donkeys for a child. He possesses all the traits of the donkey without being subject to primitive instincts unless he was gelded late in life. And since most donkeys are relatively small in stature and possess an affectionate attitude, they make excellent companions as well as mounts for children. Now, this one donkey gelding that I have here that I bought after Little Jack Horner passed in 2014, I missed having a gray donkey in his pen. And I saw Wrangler advertised on Facebook in 2017, and he looked like a really good prospect. And when I talked to the owners, I thought it was even better because this donkey gelding had grown up with a little girl when she was just a year old. Her mom got her with Wrangler, and Wrangler was just a year old.
Wow.
And she introduced the two of them, and they bonded, and the little girl would go see Wrangler all by herself. And Wrangler, to this day, is like a magnet with children. He loves them and they love him, and he sees them coming and he goes running up and down the fence, and as soon as they get to the fence, he stops right in front of them, and he's got his nose through the fence and he wants to be there right with them. And this little girl grew up with Wrangler. She was with him all the time. As far as I can tell, he wasn't professionally saddle broke. They probably just got on and rode him. The parents said she would just go out in the pen and jump on him and ride him with no saddle, no bridle, or anything else. But when she got to be 9 years old, then she decided she wanted a horse to ride, and they had to sell Wrangler to pay for the horse. And that's how I got him. But like I said, to this day, his attraction to children is just eager, enthusiastic, over the top. He's a kid donkey, for sure. We have tours, and he comes out to see all these kids in these tours and just goes manic. And my mules, too, that have been trained, when they see these kids coming on the tours, they're the same way. They come up to the adults, too, but they kind of amble up to the adults. They run to the kids. Now, donkeys can be quite stubborn when treated poorly. So it really is important that you take the time to help your child and donkey get started properly. Even an untrained donkey like Wrangler, with proper help, can become a wonderful mount for a child. In the first few weeks together, the child and the donkey should simply spend quality time together, getting to know each other. We talked about that in our last interview and how important it is just to spend time with them. How that one boy in that family of three boys that went to the show, that's what he did. He just sat around and took his donkey for a walk and his mule for a walk, and he ended up grand champion of the show. You teach your child how to handle grooming tools so that they don't hurt the animal. A lot of these grooming tools can do some really damage to them because they're made out of metal, and if they push too hard or they go over the bone, it can cut the skin. A shedding blade can cut their skin. And so it's important that the child learns how to groom and to how to apply pressure in fattier places and how to lighten up over the bones, you know. When you spend the time to teach them how to do these things, these basic things, and then give them the time to just kick around in the pen with the animal and not really do anything, just be with them, that's when real bonding time takes place. It's not when you're teaching them to do things, you know.
Right.
These things that we teach them should come in a logical and sequential order. And when your child gets good at grooming and leading and all of that, only then is it time to teach them how to tack up the animal, how to put the saddle on, how to put the bridle on. And once they learn how to do that, and they learn how, no, the saddle doesn't have to be super tight, it just needs to be snug so it doesn't roll over on the side of the animal.
Right.
And you kind of talk to them while you're teaching them that stuff, you know? And then you teach them, too, that when you finally get on and ride, you're going to have to stay balanced to keep that saddle there, because it's not going to hold you in balance. You got to be balanced over that saddle, too, and learn to ride in your own good posture. So they're kind of learning as you're going, because when you try to throw all that stuff at them all at once, a lot of things are going to get forgotten. But if you just do a little at a time and a little at a time in a logical and sequential order, then, you know, both the animal and the child have time to process what you're saying. Now, it's also important, too, to realize that children are not good listeners, and we're really bad a lot of times as adults, and we do the do as you say, not as I do thing. So it's really important that you pay attention to doing all the things that you're teaching the child, as well as talking to them about doing them. Because if they see you not doing what you're telling them to do, then they think it's okay to be a different way. For instance, if they feel they have to get rough because the animal's getting a little rough with them, and they see you doing that, then they think it's okay. That's where a lot of people, especially in the cases of mules and donkeys, when they want to do something with a mule or donkey's head, they will grab an ear and pull them down by the, and you know, that's called earing them down. And they think that's okay. And then as they get older, and especially get to be teenagers, and they're on their own training these animals and helping their friends with them, they will use those techniques, which are not good to use.
Right.
Because that is, it's abuse. You don't want to teach your child abuse. This is why when we wrote the Jasper the Mule series, we kind of fashioned it after the training program. And so when Kylie and Moxie were training Jasper and his mother through the obstacles and everything, we kept things the way that you should do it, and we kept any abusive stuff out of it. We didn't want any abusive stuff at all. We wanted to teach the child how to be humane and kind and nice and respectful to the animals. And that's what you need to remember when you're working with your animals, to be that way. And a lot of times it's hard to lose your temper about something and then keep that in mind, to be kind and not lose it, your temper, and not start cussing or getting rough with the animal, because you got to realize your kid is watching.
Mm.
Like I said before, do as I say, not as I do is very big in a kid's head. They're going to do what they see you do, not necessarily what you say. So after they've learned how to put on the saddle and everything, then it's time to teach them to ride. So you want to be very patient with them, and then realize that they're not going to have a whole lot of strength and control the way you do. They only need the very, very basic moves to work with. If you try to do any more than that with them, like tighten the reins, do this or that, then they will get in a fight with the animal. So you just want to teach them the basic and basic leg cues. So when they want to go forward, you just ask your child to ask the donkey to walk on. Use their voice and say it in a nice way. Tell the child to squeeze with your legs and don't just sit there and repetitively kick them. This is what kids like to do. They just kick, 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 and they don't say anything. But if they kick once, it's not going to hurt them. If they kick and squeeze, then they should get the desired response from when they say, walk on, walk on, walk on, you know, and then the animal goes, what, what? Oh, okay.
Yeah.
You know, and you just give them time to get it, both of them. And then if they want to turn, kids really like the idea that there's a word for left and there's a word for right. The left word is haw, the right word is G. So you tell them to pull on that right rein and say G, and the kid goes G, and he pulls on the rein. But you got to tell him to let loose too. Pull it, let loose, pull it, let loose, and say G. And if you want to go left, you go ha, and the kid goes ha. And he pulls on the left rein, and the donkey goes, what? Or the mule goes, what? Just give them time. And they figure it out. And then you tell the kid when you want to, whoa, don't just pull back on the reins. You pull back gently with a squeeze-release action and not the steady pull. And you say, whoa. And then tell the kid, just sit deep in the saddle. Put all your weight down on your seat to initiate the stop. And when the commands are given, don't be afraid to reward him with a pat on the neck or a handful of crimped oats. And you don't let the kid carry the oats while they're riding. You have them.
Right.
So when the kid wants to give the animal the reward, you say, here you go. And you tell them to extend their hands, and you put the oats in their hands. And then you tell them, keep your fingers flat. Keep your fingers flat. Don't roll your fingers up around the oats, or they might accidentally bite your fingers. So you keep your fingers flat, and then you lean over and ask them to get their nose to you. And this is what we do in the training, too, when we're breaking them and for mounting them for the first time, is we ask them to pull their heads around. So if you've trained the donkey to do that or the mule to do that, then when the kid leans over to give them the oats, they will do it. And they'll be careful about it. When we have tours here, kids' tours here, one of the things that we do is we teach these kids how to feed the animals. Now, we've taught all the animals not to charge the barn doors or to charge the gates, but when we open the gate, you stand there, and they all stand still, and they don't go running through the gates or anything like that. And so when we're in the barn, for instance, I'll open the stall door, and the last tour, we had 23 kids. And so we had the kids, okay, they said, oh, can we feed them? And I go, oh, yeah, you can feed them. That's fine. So we open up the door, and I take them one at a time. You open the door on one animal. They're standing in the doorway. And then we ask the kids to line up. They're only going to be able to deal with you one at a time, and you'll all get a turn. So you just come up, and I'll put the oats in your hand, and then you extend your hand, and you keep your fingers and your hand flat so they don't bite your fingers, and you can go ahead and feed the animal. And when you get done, you go to the end of the line. And then the next time, we'll take the whole line to the next stall. And that's how we're going to do it. And then the animals see that we're doing this in an organized fashion, that it's not mass chaos with 23 kids charging the stall door, which they all want to do in the first place.
Right.
But that's not what we let them do. We don't do it that way. If we, you know, train these animals to be quiet at the door, they don't need the onslaught of 23 kids coming at them like that, because that's just too much stimulus all at once. So you got to be fair. And so when you do that, they act accordingly. The kids act accordingly. The supervision is really good. Donkeys are very appreciative animals. If the child and the donkey are supervised correctly, it can greatly enhance the entire riding experience. The donkey or mule will protect your child with his excellent judgment, and the child will learn to be a patient and understanding person through the interaction with his donkey or mule. The reason is really very simple. Donkeys and mules will not respond unless treated fairly. Many of the riders in Great Britain began their riding career astride a donkey, and have become better riders because of it. That's why you see a lot of people doing dressage in Britain, because they recognize this logical, sequential, step-by-step approach. And through their interaction with the donkeys, they have learned to be respectful and kind to the animals and to work this way with them. And they get better results because of it. So if your child expresses an interest in riding, consider getting him a donkey gelding or even a genet if she's not pregnant or doesn't have a foal by her side. Keep in mind that she will cycle, and when she is, it's probably best to keep the child away from her. Besides being patient with children, donkey sizes are more suitable for kids, and they have ample strength to carry children, and they are easy keepers. Feed and vet bills can usually be kept to a minimum. They're tougher. Mules and donkeys are tougher animals and don't really get sick all as often as horses and ponies do. Because the mule is half donkey, he does possess a lot of the fine donkey characteristics that will make him suitable for children. I might caution you that he is also part horse and will generally get his disposition from the mare. So when you're choosing a mule for your child, I've told you before that these equines have as different types of personalities as we do as humans. So when you're looking for one, you want to look for one with a really kind and docile personality, and maybe not one that has got an alpha personality and tends to be a little ornery and pushy and resistant. Some just can't help it. It's just the way they are. And those kinds of animals are not suitable for driving either. You know, when you're picking an animal, think about the job you're going to use him for and consider the type of personality that you're going to want in that animal. And when picking a mule for your child, you'll be considering such things as his size, color. Kids are attracted to loud colors and may have a preference there, and other such traits. Be advised, too, that mini mules can be very strong and hyperactive with alpha personalities. It's that Napoleon complex thing. Ponies have it too. And in some cases, it might be better to get a larger, quieter mule for your child, or a larger, quieter donkey. But many donkeys are not alpha personalities like many mules are. They tend to be a little quieter. They just can unload a small child really easily, and you can't put a really larger kid on a mini donkey. It's, you know, although they're strong and tough and all of that, and they can carry a lot of weight, generally speaking, by the time a kid has the ability to learn how to manipulate the animal, they're too big to ride a miniature donkey. I think the miniature donkeys are probably best when it's a child that's maybe 1 or 2 years old and that can be led around, and that's about it with the minis.
Yeah.
The right donkey can usually be more reliable than any horse. I talked a little bit about how equines are with children. They have a natural curiosity when it comes to kids. When they're afraid of adults, they're not always afraid of children. And the other thing where this is true too is that equines are generally more afraid of men and find them more intimidating than they do women. Because women and children generally are around them with an unassuming, non-expectation attitude, an attitude of more like innocence and naivete, and they don't really go at the equines with expectations where the equine can pick up negative vibes. You know, children, shockingly enough, can go anywhere they want to around an equine. As long as there's not adult around them, they can go between their legs, underneath, and the equine will just watch them and even sniff them as they walk around them. They take things delicately from a child's hands unless an adult walks up, and then they'll try to snatch it, get a little bit more aggressive with it. You need to know that horses are reactionary, while mules and donkeys are intelligent, thinking equines. So if a horse takes flight from a spook or bolt, he's more likely to accidentally step on the child, where a mule or donkey will not. If you're in front of a horse, as I said before, and he bolts, he's more likely to run you over than a mule or donkey that will try to go around you if he can, if he's not trapped. Mules and donkeys really don't like stepping on squishy things.
Right.
You know, even in the trail class, if it's squishy, they don't like it.
Right.
You know. And mini mules can be a bit flighty, but they're still curious about children. Ponies, on the other hand, are notorious for bad behaviors with children. So saddle mules and donkeys make excellent babysitters. For safety's sake, it's important with all equines to teach your child how to be safe around these large animals. Remember that children do not necessarily pay attention to what you say, but will watch what you do, as I said before. Do pay attention to how you do things when you're not in front of the child, because you're going to repeat from habit whatever it is you're doing. So it would be better to just make it a good habit to do things the right way. And in the case of your feeding program, arrange your feeding program so you always feed from the outside of a pen or a stall. If you have stall feeders on the wall, then you have to step the stall, just step around the corner, put the feed in, and step back out. And arrange your feeding program so you always feed from the outside of the fences. Make these spots accessible from the outside so you won't have to be in the pen and put yourself at risk of being in the middle of a herd of animals. Because they might start fighting with each other and accidentally catch you in the middle of it. So it's better if you just arrange things so that you're safe. Just keep in mind, too, that you're going to be keeping this safe for your child, too. And spacing the feed along the fence, 16-foot intervals, will keep the animals from fighting with each other. And therefore, if your kid is even just on the outside of the fence sticking their arms through or anything, the animals won't be fighting, so you won't have the risk of them catching your kids' arms or even yours as you're throwing the hay over the fence. They need to be used to feeding along the fence. And if they are, then when the kid gets to the fence and wants the animal to come up to them, your kid is going to be a lot safer because the animal won't have gotten these aggressive behaviors part of their habitual way of behaving. They will be much mannerly about the way they interact with the child or interact with anybody, any visitors or anybody that might come to your ranch and want to pet your animals. They'll come up to the fence and offer their head. You know, I've seen this a dozen and one times with my animals when we have tours. They all come up to the fence, and they want to meet whoever's there, and they're very polite and considerate about it. They line up, and I've never played favorites with them as far as the rewards are concerned. So even if they're at the end of the line, they know they're going to get their reward, so they don't start fighting for it. They'll stand in line and wait until I get to them with the reward. I don't let strangers feed the rewards when I'm giving rewards to multiple animals along a fence line that are in a herd, because they are used to my verbal commands too. And strangers would not know how to talk to them properly to get them to behave properly. So I just don't let them feed the oats to the animals that are in a herd. But I will take them in the barn and let them feed the individual animals, because then it's just one-on-one and they're less likely to get in any trouble.
Right.
When you're, yeah, don't you think?
Oh,
you know,
yeah.
You're setting up the situation for success. And that's what you want to keep in mind. In that same state of mind, when you're teaching your child how to groom and everything, when you brought the animal out of the stall or pen and teaching them how to bridle and saddle them, you need to teach them how to handle their head around their ears and eyes and everything, how to pet the animal and don't go against the hair. And as I said, never use the ears to hold the head still.
Right.
When you're teaching your child to walk around the equine, teach them not to run or be abrupt in their movements, to walk deliberately and carefully, and either walk really close to the animal or give them a wide berth and get out of kicking range completely, not part way where they can hit you. Those two positions are really important. When you select a saddle for your child, be sure to get a saddle that you can adjust the stirrups to the right length for your child. And if you can't get a youth saddle that will fit your child, they do have stirrups that you can attach to adult saddles that can be set to the proper length for your child. So when your child is riding the animal, they have everything they need to support their balance. If their legs are just hanging, they're gonna be going back and forth to the animal's motion. Because then, as we mentioned before, in the beginning, they're not going to have the body strength to hold themselves in position, and they'll need that extra support of the stirrups. So, again, it's a case of setting the situation up so that they can succeed and giving them every opportunity to succeed with all the things that you're doing. It might be because long ears have not been publicly shown until recently in horse shows and things like that, that kids have not taken an active interest in the promotion of long ears. But I gotta say, in the last 20 years, that has gone up. And kids find these animals really attractive. They think they're so funny looking, and they're so odd that they are kid magnets. And the nice thing about it is they've got the traits to really be polite and considerate with kids, which only makes the kids like them even more. If kids get to show these animals, which a lot of them do out at Bishop Mule Days, you even have tiny little kids riding these 17-hand mules in the parade along a parade route with no assistance from their parents. Their parents are riding animals that their animal is following. So if you keep that in mind, you know that group animals that get along together are going to be following each other. So you pick an animal that's a really good follower if you're going to take your kid in a parade or have them at a show or anything like that, because it's just, again, keeping them safe. The values that these kids learn when dealing with donkeys and mules will stand them in good stead through their whole life, not to mention all the fun and joy they'll discover in having such an interactive and affectionate companion. And because I've written this book, A Guide to Raising and Showing Mules, which I fashioned after the 4-H manual for horses, with the consideration for mules included in it, a lot of 4-H leaders are allowing kids to use mules and donkeys as 4-H projects, as FFA projects. And there's even kids that are doing roping off of mules in Little Bridges rodeo events now. We've come a long way with these mules and donkeys. And having the kids, which are our future, to take the mules and donkeys into the future, they're more important than anyone else. And it's really important that they learn to handle these animals the right way and get the right things out of them so that they can grow up and be long ears ambassadors themselves and take these mules into the future and show people how much fun they really are. In the spirit of generosity and to give children a healthy pursuit as they grow, people might consider making long ears a part of their lives and give a homeless donkey, burro, or mule a chance. They're not as bad as horses that have been abused. They are, as I said, a thinking animal, and when approached in a kind, respectful, and considerate way, given a lot of patience and time to learn things, they also realize the individuality of the different people that they meet. So they can discern whether or not a person is abusive or not. And even though they may have been abused in the past, they and acted really horrible, they may not act the same way with somebody who is non-abusive in the future. And that's why they deserve a chance. They shouldn't automatically be deemed vicious, aggressive, or untrainable, or any of those things, or irretrievably abused.
Right.
No, they really shouldn't. Now, horses, because they just get flighty and explode, they're not thinking.
Mm-hmm.
The horses that have been abused are most likely going to revert back to their old behaviors, and you never know when they're going to do it. Donkeys and mules tend to have less issues and to be more sedate overall rescue animals than horses. When the difference between donkeys and mules are a little bit, because the mule has part horse in it. So when you're assessing them and you've got a mule that is really, really bad about running off and doesn't want to be caught, probably isn't the best choice for your child, or even you for that matter. So you want to pick an animal that welcomes your attention, who seems affectionate, that will stick with you as long as you want to look at them. And if you adhere to the guidelines that I've described, you probably won't be disappointed. But take the time to go through all these guidelines and to think about them and to adjust your own training program accordingly and be willing to lower your expectations and take on a program that is much more patient, slow, logical, sequential way of approaching your animals. Don't get your child all excited about just riding. Get them excited about all the different things that you can do on the ground, starting with feeding, grooming, leading, ground driving, lunging, and then eventually get to riding. And then redo all the things that you did when you were leading and ground driving, because that's how you introduce them to obstacles. If they've already learned how to do obstacles while they're leading, the animals are going to be much more willing to go through the obstacles. They won't be afraid of them. the child, if they've done them when they're leading, will have a better seat over them, because leading over obstacles requires quite a bit of coordination. If the child has been leading his animal through the hourglass pattern first and learning how to set them up like in a showmanship class, they'll be ready for the showmanship class. They will get ready for leading through an obstacle trail course. They will get ready, you know, later at ground driving in the hourglass pattern, ground driving over obstacles and all that, and they'll learn all these movements, and they'll get more and more balanced in their physical development and be able to do all these things. So by the time they get on a ride, they're a really well-prepared little equestrian. They can balance themselves in the saddle, and they know what all the cues are. They have gotten together and bonded with their animal and gotten in sync with all these cues and things that they need to do. So riding is maybe the last step, but it's not necessarily the most fun step, but it's going to be rewarding when you get there, because when you get there, you're going to be ready to be there. And this greatly minimizes accidents.
That is so neat. Now, I think I need to go out and round up a bunch of kids so that I can work with them and teach them the proper way to be handling mules and donkeys so that the legacy just lives on. This is awesome.
I think this is a really good idea, and I could even take it one step further with those kids. How about having those kids take some of your animals, some of the smaller ones, maybe to assisted living places.
Oh, yes.
And showing them to the elders.
Oh, yeah.
And exchanging stories with the elders.
That is ideal.
Isn't that what we used to do as families?
Right.
When we were settling this country?
Sure.
And when kids are able to do that, it gives them self-esteem. It gives them confidence. It gives them a feeling of importance. And it gives them skills that will work for a lifetime in any sense, whether they're dealing with human beings or dealing with animals, whether they're dealing with big animals like equines or smaller animals like dogs.
Oh, yeah.
My website is at www.lucky3ranch.com, and I have a second one for children at jasperthemule.com. We also have a Facebook page, Meredith Hodges Public Figure page. I do have a personal page, but it's maxed out. But I also put the same thing on both pages. And if you don't find what you want posted on Facebook or on my website, you are welcome to email me at meredith@lucky3ranch.com, and I answer all my mail promptly. And you can also call me at 1-800-816-7566. If you don't get me straight up, leave a message. I answer all my calls too.
Awesome. Wow.
Happy trails, Cindy, and I'll see you next time.
Okay.
Gotta go. My mule is looking for me.
Mule Talk is an Every Cowgirl's Dream production.